Okay, great. So let us start the lecture. So today we'll continue talking about amenability, and we'll see other definitions. Actually, we'll touch upon different subjects concerning groups. Okay, well, from geometric, analytic, probabilistic point of view. And we'll see that in this context we get a very short, natural definitions of characterizations of amenability, and maybe it's one of the signs that it's a very important and deep notion, that there are so many simple equivalent characterizations relating this notion to very different. Very different fields. Okay, so as we said last time, it's enough to restrict attention, as far as amenability is concerned, to countable groups. Yeah, it's not so difficult to see that a group is amenable if and only if every countable subgroup is amenable, or even every finitely generated subgroup is amenable. So let me state another characterization of amenability due to Fellner, and let me state for countable groups. So we will suppose for today that gamma is countable. And in '50s, Fellner proved the following characterization of amenability. So the group gamma is amenable if and only if there exists exists a sequence of finite subsets in this group AN such that the sequence is more and more invariant, namely if you consider AN and AN translated by any element in gamma, so gamma here is any element in the group, then the symmetric difference, is it the standard relation? Okay. So these are elements which are in the union but not in the intersection, that the number of such elements divided by the size of AN when n tends to infinity, this tends to zero. Yeah, so it's more and more invariant. And actually, last time, you remember we talked about the proof that integers are amenable. And so let me remind you this well, conditions of amenability we had. So we had the subspace consisting of translations of sums of bounded functions minus the translations. Okay, so F was L infinity of gamma, and gamma was any element in the group gamma. And we've seen that one can prove that the group is amenable if gamma is amenable if the infimum of H is less or equal to zero for every H in H. Okay. And the way, yes? Okay, so thank you very much for this remark. Indeed, very often this Fellner's theorem is stated with additional conditions on the set AN. For instance, the one that you mentioned, that the union should be the whole group gamma. However, it's not necessary. It's not necessary. Theorem as stated without this additional conditions is true. However, what one can prove that if such a sequence exists with just this property, there is also a sequence satisfying modified sequence satisfying additional conditions that you mentioned. So not only one, but also that the union would be, and I could mention other conditions. It's became kind of theorem itself. What are other properties you can ask for this sequence? But I believe the theorem, as it states, is true. But you are right that somehow in literature, it's usually stated with additional conditions, which are not necessary. Okay. So that's what we've seen last time, and we said that it's an exercise to verify it for integers. And in general, the way to the condition one needs to do it is exactly this condition. So why? Maybe let me explain. So this is. Sorry. H of gamma. So H is a function. It's element in H. So it's a function on the group. Okay. So it's a value. So we're taking here infimum of this function over the whole group. Okay. Now, if the group is finite, this is obviously true. Okay. Because functions we consider it are functions minus the translations. So if you take the sum over of the function over the whole group is zero, okay? So if the sum of the values is zero, certainly for finite, we're talking about finite group, at some element it's non-positive, okay? So for finite groups this is obvious, and now this condition, which tells you that there are finite, the group it's not necessarily finite, but there are finite subsets which are almost invariant under translations, enable you to adapt this argument from finite groups to this finite subsets, and you can also conclude for groups admitting such a sequence that this condition is true. In particular, for integers, as a subset AN, sequence AN. So maybe let me indeed consider the subset such that the union is not the whole group. So we will just take elements from 1 up to N. And such a sequence AN, of course, has this property, because if you consider its translation by a fixed element, the symmetric difference has a fixed size. Okay, and we're dividing by the size, which goes to infinity. So this is true, okay? So indeed, for integers, as this is for gamma equal to z, for integers you can consider this sequence. Okay, and the fact that this condition, okay, which before we used to prove amenability, is equivalent, the fact that for any amenable group there exists such a sequence. Because for groups which were amenable at the time, you could easily construct such a sequence, it was thought that, in a sense, that's the end of the theory. Okay, that's the end of the theory. With this characterization of amenability, one can very easily prove amenability. Okay, and only recently there are new examples of amenable groups, which actually go against the predictions concerning algebraic structure of such groups. we know that they are amenable using other characterizations, and it's there are still no explicit constructions of this of such sequences of almost invariant subsets, which actually are called Ferner sequences. Yes. So it's a finite. So H consists of all functions which can be written as a finite sums of function bounded function minus its translation. By gamma i's. But yeah, the point is that we consider only finite sums. Okay, it's a linear subspace. Yes, there is no restriction. There is no restriction. So gamma i's are arbitrary elements in gamma. We consider all such combinations. So we consider all bounded functions and all elements gamma in the gamma i in gamma. Okay, just the sum has to be finite. Okay. And the exercise was that for a free group, one should construct H such that actual H of gamma is always equal to 1. Okay. Using paradoxical decomposition. Okay. Then in the 50s, many other characterizations of amenability appeared. And let me talk here about probabilistic characterization of amenability. We'll talk about random walks on groups. Okay. So the setting will be the following. To a group, and here we even suppose that the group is finitely generated, so that there exists a finite set of generators S. And for convenience, let us also suppose that it's symmetric, that if S is a generator, also its inverse will be in the set of generators. It's not restrictive. We can always add inverses to generators. And to such a pair, gamma and S will associate a graph called a Cayley graph, gamma S, which is defined as follows. So the vertices of this graph are elements of the group, and we'll put the edges between two elements if they differ by generator. So this will be unoriented edges, gamma S gamma. Okay, gamma S is in the set of of generators. Okay, very well. So for instance, if we consider a group of integers, and as the generators will take standard generators, so plus minus one, so as the Cayley graph, we obtain a line. Another group that we considered here was a free group of rank 2, irreducible words on two letters, A and B. And so as generators, we can take indeed these letters and the inverses. Okay, and in this case, the Cayley graph, the Cayley graph will be a graph of degree 4. So degree, the number of edges at every vertex, is the number of generators. And in this case, if it's a free group, there will be no loops in this graph. Because it's a free group, there are no non-trivial relations. So as the graph, we will obtain a graph of degree 4 with no loops, so-called tree. Tree of degree degree 4. Okay, very well. And on such a graph, we'll do what is called a simple random walk. Okay? So it will be random walk on the vertices, of the graph. And we'll start at the vertex. Let us start at the vertex, which corresponds to the identity element in the group. Actually, maybe let me draw a bigger picture. So let us also consider maybe Z square, and as generators, we'll take plus minus 0, 1, plus minus 1, 0. So in this way, we obtain a square grid. Okay, here say it's identity element. And the random walk is defined as follows. So we start at the vertex corresponding to identity. And then in the next step, we choose one of its four, in this case four, neighboring vertices. We choose them with the same probability, 1/4, and we go to the one we chosen. At this vertex, we do the same thing. We choose one of four neighbors with the same probability, and we go there, for instance, here, and so on. Okay. So let us denote probability of return after n steps to identity Pn identity. Okay. So it's a probability of return to identity after n steps. Okay, and then Kesten proved the following characterization of amenability. So it's also in 50s, after the work of Fellner. He proved that gamma is amenable. Okay, if asymptotically, this probability of return is the largest possible. So if you take probability of return after 2n steps, okay, so we do it after 2n steps because for instance for the graphs we've seen after odd number of steps you cannot return to identity. Okay, it's one needs even number. If one takes the nth, 2nth root, well, this limit always exists, and it's maximal equal to 1, if and only if the group is amenable. Okay, so maybe a few comments about this theorem. So we know that probability is a property of the group. Okay. However, for a given group, you can choose different set of generators, and probability of return to identity heavily depends on the set of generators. Okay. Here, if I consider different set of generators consisting with these generators plus maybe plus minus 1, 1, okay, I would, then we would add these edges. So for instance, here probability even after then would be non-zero after could be non-zero after odd number of of steps. Okay, so this heavily depends on the set of generators, and also this limit in general depends on the set of generators. However, for amenable groups, this is independent on the set of generators and is equal precisely to one. Okay, so this is one remark. Maybe another remark is that well, we can talk about this simple random walk probability of return not only for KD graphs but for any graph. Okay, so in this case we can define the notion, so extend the notion of amenability not only to the setting, extended to the setting of graphs, for instance. And it's an interesting and important generalization. And right, so it's important that here there is no structure of a group. There is no structure of the group involved. Okay, so it's started to be interesting. We got like this. Maybe we can try to do a count of different characterizations of amenability we've seen already. So the first one was with invariant means. Okay, that this was this original definition of von Neumann. Another one was using paradoxical decompositions. Okay, that the groups are non-amenable if and only if there exists this paradoxical decomposition. Okay, another was using the space H. Another one is using this almost invariant subsets of the group, yeah, which looks I think really the simplest one. Okay, it's like you have this proof for for integers, which is one line proof that it's amenable group. And we also seen the characterization of amenability, probabilistic characterization. And I could give you many more characterizations of amenability, which are also very, very simple, very, very natural. So it's a fundamental notion for concerning groups, no matter what part of group theory associated to groups you touch upon, you get a very simple characterization of amenability. So maybe let us mention other characterizations of amenability. Also, so let me also mention the one due to Fellner, which is also analytic one. Okay. So by the way, for what is also interesting with this characterization that for non-amenable groups, you obtain an interesting invariant. Okay, you know that this limit is for any set of generators is less or strictly less than one, and it's interesting question and in most cases very difficult to compute. This limit for non-amenable might depend on the set of generators. Pardon? Sorry. Okay, so for instance, well, we know already that F2 free group is a non-amenable, is a non-amenable group. So this limit is non-amenable, and one can compute this limit. This limit is non-zero; it's always non-zero. Okay, actually, and once you fix the set of generators, the minimal value, once you fix the size of generating set, the minimal value of this you can get is what you get for a free group. Okay, for of this rank. So this limit, it's always between 1 and what you get for a free group of rank corresponding to the size of this generating set. It's equal to the spectral radius of the random walk operator that I'll define now. Right, exactly. It's so we can look at this as a definition of spectral radius for some operator. I'll write it right now. Okay, so for instance, if you take four generators, four generators, so in this case, this limit, when you take 2n fruit p to n identity, the limit when n tends to infinity, I think it will be equal to square root of 3/2. Okay, and then possible values of this limit for groups generated by two elements will be between this number and 1, and strictly less than 1 for amenable groups. And let me now answer precisely your question about spectral radius. So the operator that we'll consider will be the operator acting on L2 of the group, defined as follows. So MF of gamma, it will be the sum of the translations of the function by generators, and we take we divide the sum by the size of S. Okay, because we suppose that S is symmetric, this is a self-adjoint operator, and indeed the L2 norm of this operator, it can be computed using the spectral radius formula. So it's exactly equal to the it's a limit when n tends to infinity to n. Okay, and we get in this way another theorem of Kesten, that gamma is amenable if and only if the norm of this operator, L2 norm, is equal to 1. Yes, is equal to 1. Okay, so it's analytic characterization of amenability. in terms of norms of some operators, and the same remarks as for this theorem applies also to this characterization, okay, that you can consider it, for instance, for arbitrary. Sorry? Yes, yes, exactly. Exactly, exactly. Yes, and indeed. Indeed, so it gives us another characterization and right, another invariant for. Okay, very well. I could continue with other characterizations of amenability, but maybe let me switch to the case of finite groups or finite graphs. So the notions we're going to discuss here, amenability property T, they're really interesting for infinite groups, right? Amenability for finite groups, so all this, it's all this is completely trivial, right? And also all this characterization in terms of the mean, in terms of almost invariant subsets. So for a finite group, you take just the whole group, okay? And you take. So it's all these notions are interesting. All this is interesting for infinite groups. However, let me mention something which could be thought of as analog of amenability or non-amenability for finite objects, finite finite groups, finite finite graphs. So let me talk about notion of expanding graphs, which originally was motivated by the considerations from computer science, and but nowadays found application to many fields of mathematics, including including operator algebras. Okay, so I should erase. Maybe right. Okay. Are there any questions concerning these characterizations? Okay. So we will consider X is a finite graph. For although when we see the definitions, we don't have to suppose that every vertex has the same number of edges, but it's not interesting generalization. So you can very well think that all vertices have the same degree, okay? Like in the case of K graphs. And for a finite graph, we'll define its isoperiodic constant as follows. So that's a graph X. For a subset of vertices A, we'll define its boundary as the set of edges with one extremity inside A and another one outside. So that's the edge in the boundary. This one, and also these two edges are in the boundary of A. Okay, maybe even let me write it formally. So the for the subset of the vertices A, the boundary is defined as the edges X, Y. X is in A and Y is outside of A. That's the size, that's the that's the boundary. Okay. And we'll be in, okay. And we'll define the isoperimetric constant h of x by analogy with the definition in Riemannian geometry as the minimum, well, the size of the boundary compared to the size of A. Okay? And we'll take this minimum over all subsets in X, well, except that the size shouldn't be too large, because, for instance, if you take A to be all vertices, then the boundary is empty. Okay? So the natural restriction is that the size of A is at most half the size of X. Okay, so we're considering the edges between A and its complement, and we divide this by the size of the by the size of the of this smaller, yeah, oh, by the size of A. Isoperimetric. It's by analogy with Riemannian geometry. It's called also Cheeger constant. Okay, so isoperimetric constant. Well, and we'll be interested in graphs with a large isoperimetric constant, so that any subset would be connected by many edges with the rest of the graph. Okay, and the originally the interest in such graphs was that you can think about this as a communication network, right? That nodes in the in your network correspond to vertices, and the edges to connections. Okay, and you want this graph to be connected so that you can communicate over this network, but also very reliable, so that if you lose some connections, if you erase some edges, the graph still remains connected. Okay? And this can be guaranteed by the fact that this isoperimetric constant is large, that every subset has many edges going out. So if you lose some of them, still the subset will remain connected to the rest of the network. So you would like to have graphs which have large isoperimetric constant. On the other hand, in order to, well, but something like this could be achieved, for instance, if you had complete graph. Yeah, you put edges between all vertices. But from the practical point of view, this is not interesting because you use too many connections. So the question is whether you can still produce graphs with a large isoperimetric constant, close to the one like for a complete graph, but with a large isoperimetric constant, but still using few connections. So the condition is the following. So it's a definition of expanders. So the condition that we use few connections will be that we'll declare that the we're considering all graphs of a fixed degree, for instance, three. Okay, at every vertex, we will have just three edges. So a sequence so a sequence of finite graphs xn of degree k is called a sequence expanders if, well, we want these graphs to be models of such highly connected networks of arbitrary size. So the size should go to infinity, but the isoperimetric constant, so isoperimetric constants of all these graphs should be bounded below by some strictly positive constant. See. Okay. So the size at every vertex you have, say, three vertices. The size of this graph goes to infinity, yet the isobutynic constant doesn't go to zero. Okay. You cannot ask better. Yeah, because if the degree is k, then the isobutynic constant is at most k. Right? There are at most k edges at every vertex going out. Even k minus 1 can be even improved. But you cannot ask better than a constant. You cannot ask better than a constant. OK. So I said, as you could think about degree equal to 3, because if the degree is equal to 2, you get cyclic graphs, okay? With the degree 2, you got cyclic graphs, and of course, cyclic graphs are very easy to disconnect. You just remove any two edges, and the graph is not connected anymore, okay? So the degree should be at least 3. Okay, the expanding graphs, the construction is a big subject of on its own. What can I say if you see this definition for the first time? Why it's interesting and why it attracted so much attention? Why is it difficult to construct such graphs? And actually, it seems to me that despite all remarkable progress, there is still no easy solution to this problem. Like easy example where you could get easy explanation why it's a sequence of expanders. Okay, so yeah, it's a difficult task. How to convince you that it's a difficult problem? Okay, if you see it for the first time. So, well, maybe I guess that what could be like your first natural idea to construct such graphs. Well, you can look at the definition of isobutynic constant also for infinite graphs. Okay, in this case, you just take infimum over the size of the boundary divided by the size of A for all finite subsets. Okay, and then for a fixed degree, it's very easy to see that the graph, infinite graph with the largest isobutynic constant, is the graph with no loops, a tree. Okay, if you have regular graph of degree 3 with no loops, then it's easy to see that if you consider any finite subset of vertices, the size of its boundary is at least the size of A. Okay, and among so the isobutynic constant for T3 actually is equal to 1. Okay, and among all graphs of degree 3, infinite graphs of degree 3, it's easy to see that the largest one is for the graph with no loops at all. Okay, so if it was so easy to construct infinite graphs using trees with positive isobutynic constant, and if they are the ones which have the largest isobutynic constant, so maybe as examples of expanders of finite graphs with large isobutynic constant, you could consider finite trees. Okay, but if you take a finite tree, it has the worst possible isobutynic constant. Okay, because if you take finite tree, you remove just one edge, and it's not connected anymore. Okay, so it's an indication that something interesting is happening. Okay, that it's so easy for infinite graphs and becomes much more interesting, intriguing for finite graphs. Okay, it's an indication, and I guess there are many other natural graphs to look at, and unfortunately, you see that it doesn't work. Okay, you don't get a sequence of expanders. Okay, so actually, the first results concerning existence of any questions? No? Of such graphs were obtained by probabilistic methods. Okay. So what using theory of random graphs, so what we'll see is that actually if you take a random finite graph, it will have a large isothermic constant. Okay, and the argument will be easy, so probably we'll have time to see the more than 10 minutes. Okay, more than 10 minutes. So we will prove that most graphs have large isothermic constant, and therefore expanders do exist. So in the theory of random graphs, there is no really like one model, and the reason is that what would be the most natural is to, when you consider finite graphs of the given size, to count them with respect to the isomorphism relation. This is the most natural thing to do. However, this is difficult. Okay, distinguishing graphs up to isomorphism might be really difficult. So the whole idea to make this argument very simple, to give you very, 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 very easy proof, is to change the counting. Okay, so I'll consider the following model. So we consider vertices 1, 2, up to n, one of set vertices which are called I inputs, and another set O outputs, which we also label by 1, 2, up to n. Okay, so in this way, we have two n vertices, and now the edges, the set of edges, will be given by permutations in this on the on n elements. So let us call it pi 1 pi k. Okay, if you want to have graph of degree k, we'll choose k permutations. Okay, and then the set of edges is defined as follows. So for the vertex I in the set of inputs, this vertex will be connected with its image in O by one of the permutations, so pi j of I. So that's the set of edges. So in this way, we obtain a graph on 2n vertices of degree k. Okay, these are very special graphs because you have these two subsets, and the edges only between two subsets. I could present you the way of constructing all graphs of a given size, but I want to give you a proof of existence of expanders in 10 minutes, so that's why we stick to this model. But you can very easily figure out how to get a statement which would look like something about all graphs. Okay. So we will consider graphs of this kind. Here, I also slightly modify definition of the isopergic constant. So we consider for the subset A in I, we'll define its boundary, D prime of A, as the set of vertices in O, which are connected by an edge with A. In other words, it's an image of the subset A by all these permutations, image in O. So the modified isobaryonic constant, H prime, of this graph, it will be the minimum, the size of this boundary, D prime, divided by the size of A, and it's over all subsets in vertices of the size at most n over 2, at most half the size of I. Okay, in a sense, it's a it's a wrong definition of isopermeability constant because it's always at least one. Okay, the size of the image by these permutations is at least size of A. Okay, so it's a definition you should you should forget this definition as soon as the proof is finished. but we will. It's interesting for us because we can get from this the bound on the real isopermeability constant. So the real isopermeability constant is at least this H prime minus 1. Okay, so this is that's why we need it. Okay. And the theorem that we prove, it's a theorem that in literature, it's attributed to Pinsker. Also, there were some earlier some statements which are close to this one. So the theorem is the following one: if k is at least 3, then the number of graphs in the set 2n k, such that the isopermeability constant of all these graphs is at least 1/2, divided by the number of all graphs. Okay. And now an important remark is, what do we mean by the size of the subset? So here, we do not count graphs up to isomorphism. Okay, the graphs are defined by permutations. So we say that two graphs are different if the permutations are different. Okay, if the permutations are different. So of course, even though if you change the order, you still obtain graphs which are isomorphic. But it doesn't bother us. We want to, at the end, we want to prove that there is at least one family of expanders. So what we're going to prove that the limit when n tends to infinity of this is equal to 1. Okay. In other words, if you choose at random k permutations, k is fixed, for instance 3, n is very large, then the graph you obtain by connecting I vertex I with its image by permutations will give you a graph which almost surely will have isopermeability constant at least 1/2. Okay, so although it's so difficult to give explicit construction, random choice of permutation will give you a graph with the large isothermal constant. Okay, and hopefully we have 5 minutes left, so it should be enough to give a proof of this result of Pinsker. Are there any questions concerning this statement? Okay, so proof. Sorry? Yes. So the graphs have degree k.
No, but if you take a random pi 1, pi k, and pi 1 and pi 2 by 10, 1 to 1.
Yes.
There
might be multiple edges. There might be multiple edges. Although, also, but from this one, I also get expanders without multiple edges, but it's not. Yes, the one, the way we defined, but it doesn't matter. Like, no matter whether you count with multiplicity or not, because the degree is fixed, you get the existence of expanders. The constant might change, but it will be also a sequence of expanders. Okay, so what is the proof? What is the proof? So we said that we in order to estimate this constant, we'll use the constant h prime. So what we're going to prove actually is that h prime is at least 3 halves. Okay, that's what we are going to prove. Okay, so the way we do it, we will estimate, we'll bound the number of permutation which lead to graphs with a small isoperty constant, okay? Which lead to isoperty constant which is less than this number. Okay, and we want to show that there won't be many of them. That asymptotically, it will tend to zero, the percentage. Okay, so what does it mean that the h prime is at most 3 halves? Well, it means that by definition of this isoperty constant, that in the set of inputs, you have a subset A, okay, the size of A is at most n over 2, and in O, you have a subset B, the size of B is equal to 3 halves of A, and all the edges that start in A end up in B. Right? That's what it means, that the isoperty constant H prime is at almost three halves. Okay, so let us estimate the number of choices of permutations such that we are in this situation. Okay, so it will be so the number of let me call them like bad choices. Okay, expanders are good. Yeah, there's a number of bad choices of permutations. It can be bounded as follows. So we have to first of all, well, we estimated the number of choices for A and B, and then number of choices for permutations that evaluated at A, they get values in B. So it will be the sum over all subsets A in I. Sum of size of A at most n over 2, all subset B in O, and the size of B is 3/2 A. Okay? Actually, it's like there could be even smaller, B of a smaller size, that all values at A will be at B, but we can always enlarge it to have it 3/2 of A. And now, given A and B, how many choices we have for permutations that the value at A is in B? Well, let us do it for one permutation, and then we will take to the power k. So how many choices we have for one permutation that the values at A will be in B? Well, if we take the first vertex in A, the number of choices for the values is the size of B. Okay, so it will be the size of B. Now, for the second, it will be the size of B minus 1, and so on. And for the last vertex in A, how many choices do we have? You said B minus A plus 1. Okay, great. Okay. And what about vertices which are outside of A? So as far as vertices outside of A are concerned, there are no restrictions concerning the value. Okay? It might be outside of A, B, it might be in B, it doesn't matter. So the number of choices, it will be n minus the size of A factorial. Okay? And this was just for the one permutation. So if we have k choices, then we take it to the power k. Okay, that's our estimate. Maybe let us rewrite it. So let us write it as a sum over the size of A. Okay, so the size, say the size of A is equal to I, so it's the sum from I equal to 1 to n over 2. And now, how many choices we have for subsets A? So the size is A. There are n vertices, so it's n choose I choices for the subset A. Now, for the subset B, it will be n choose 3/2 I. Okay, and now. What can we say, how can we write this one? So the size of B, it's 3/2 I, okay? So let me write it as 3/2 I factorial, okay? So then we have to divide by size of B minus size of A factorial. So this is 3/2. Minus 1, so this is 1/2. So it's I over 2 factorial, and this is n minus I factorial. Okay, and all this to the power k. Okay, very good. And now the number of O choices, this is n factorial to the power k, and it's an easy exercise to prove that this divided by this tends to zero when n tends to infinity. Okay, so that's the end. That's the end of the proof that most most graphs have large isobaric constant. We've seen in this proof that it's at least 1/2. And in this way, we get existence of expanders. Of course, for applications, you would like to have explicit constructions of such graphs. And it took some time to obtain first explicit examples of models of this highly connected networks. And about these explicit constructions, we will learn next week. We'll talk about Kasdan's property T and construction of Margulis using groups with property T, constructions of expanders. Okay, thank you very much. Right, so the result of Pinsker is from 70s, and apparently there were also earlier results, not really in the language of expanders, but apparently which are very close to to this result concerning expanders. And maybe it's what is like interesting to so next week we will talk about explicit examples, and what is interesting that the I'll show you this this argument really in detail. We will understand, okay, but you have the whole weekend to think, trying to construct maybe yourself. But let me say a few things. So first of all, the argument, the original argument we'll see, will give you no information about isobaric constant. Okay, we'll see that we will prove that they are expanders, but without getting any non-trivial bound on isobaric constant. Okay, so then it took several more years to get some explicit estimates on this. On this isobaric constant. What is interesting that this argument still gives the best estimates concerning isobaric constant. Okay, so this that here we've seen just that it's at least 1/2. Actually, you can get the bound here also, which using the same argument, which depends on k, okay? So you get a function which is linear in k, grows linearly with k. And for explicit constructions, you cannot get as good as bounds as you get from random methods. So there are still things to be done. Right. So, so one can give give inequalities between. So yeah. So we have for the graphs we have this isobaric constant and say yeah, and we have this the other one which is the norm of this operator, right? So there are. So what really counts is the gap between the norm and one. Okay, between the so one. So here we have the isobaric constant, and on the other hand, we have one minus. Okay, so let me. Do I have like 1 minute? It's interesting to maybe answer this question in detail, so that next week we won't have to. Okay, so if we talk about infinite graphs, we know that non-amenability corresponds to the fact that this is non-zero. Okay, on the other hand, one can, in terms of isotropy constant, for infinite graph, this isotropy constant should be strictly positive. And there are inequalities between that it's not that one is the function of another, but from this you can get a lower bound on this quantity, and from this quantity you can get a lower bound on this spectral gap. Now, what about so for infinite graphs, we said that we can talk about isotropy constant, that there is no restriction on the size. Okay, to get something non-trivial, isotropy constant for finite graphs, we consider subsets of the size at most half. Okay, so this is the isotropy constant for finite graphs. Now, what is the, so for finite graphs, of course, the norm of this operator is one. Okay, you say just constant functions. So what is the analog, spectral analog for finite graphs? Okay, then you look at the, so you look at the eigenvalues of this operator, okay, and there is eigenvalue one corresponding to constant function. So let me call it lambda zero. Okay, and then you look at the second eigenvalue after lambda zero. Okay, so this is the spectral information for finite graphs. Okay, then the the next eigenvalue after one. And again, you can what you can prove that being expanders, that H is uniformly bounded away from zero, it's equivalent to the fact that one minus lambda one, that so-called spectral gap, is uniformly bounded away from zero, maybe but by another constant. Okay, and another. And again, here you can get estimates. One, you know C prime, you get some lower bound on C. And if you know C, you get lower bound on C prime. But there is no function. Okay, so H is not the function of the spectral gap. But there are, the asymptotic behavior is the same. Okay, so one can define expanders with this condition, or with the condition that lambda one of this spectral gap for all these graphs is uniformly bounded away from zero. This is the same. No, so here I don't use the so for the graph, the operator M is defined as follows: MF at the vertex X. Okay, it will be the sum of the values of F at the neighboring vertices Y, which are connected to X by an edge. And we divide it by the degree of X, the number of edges at the vertex X. Right. So this operator M, random walk operator, can be considered on any graph, not necessarily the Cayley graph. However, maybe I'll say immediately that the explicit examples that we're going to see next week are expanders, are examples of Cayley graphs. Okay, this will be Cayley graphs of finite groups, which are quotients of one given infinite group with property T. Yes, so there are many references. It's the subject which is, yeah, there are many books. So maybe for the next lecture, I will give you some references. But indeed, it was studied extensively. All these relations. However, although so much is known about this, there are still. Yeah, yes, of course. So, so as we said, for infinite graphs, the norm, it was this. the norm was equal to. This was the spectral radius formula. To the 2n root of the probability of return after 2n steps. Okay. And it's what should be also mentioned that so the isotropic constant it's related to the sets with the small boundary to the Fellner sets. Okay, these are the ones which realize minimum, and that there is a different intuition concerning the spectral properties of this operator. So indeed, one has now examples of a group for which one can prove the non-amenability using this spectral Kesten theorem, that the norm of the random walk operator is strictly less than one. Okay, and still one cannot see explicitly why the isobaryonic constant is equal to zero. How to construct this Fellner sequence? Okay, so although these are like equivalent definition, in practice, it's very different studying this geometric condition and the spectral condition. Okay. And pardon? Function minus its translation. Right. Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah. Okay, great. Yeah, yeah. Very good. Yes. Yeah. I didn't. Right. So the operator you suggest is the discrete Laplace operator, right? So indeed, right. So the right. So what is called the analog of the Laplace operator in this context, discrete Laplace operator is defined as identity minus M MN, okay? And well, if you look, so the, for instance, if you look at integers at this operator, and then you declare that the difference between consecutive integers is epsilon, and you apply this operator defined by epsilon square, then epsilon to zero, this will tend to the second derivative. Okay, so that's the way to see that it's. And there are other ways of seeing that it's it has many analogies with the Laplace operator. Okay, so I didn't mention it because from the spectral point of view, the spectrum of translate all these conditions into the spectrum of the Laplace operator, because its spectrum is just 1 minus the spectrum of M. Right. So there is the whole, then a theory about this. Okay, today we had like one hour, and I wanted to already present you the history of this whole subject, but there are very important, like the whole subject on itself around this operators quantities we've seen.